Grace and peace from our Lord Jesus Christ. This is Sister Liberty Ming back here once again with another teaching for you. So the last time we spoke, we talked about the house of God being a mess, the people of God being a mess, and how we are in need of sanctification and purification and preparation of the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we know that the church is in a particular state at the moment, and how it's the church's job to prepare itself, to get the house in order. It is our job as Christians to make sure that we are a part of the solution and not a part of the problem. We are called to be set apart from the world and not of the world. So we're in the world as believers and as Christians, but we are not of the world. So we are to be separate. The things of the world we should not be associated with, because that reflects back on who we are as a people. We are the people of God, and so that means we represent God here on the earth. And so it matters how we live our lives. It matters if we are walking in hypocrisy or not. It matters if we are living a double life or not. It matters if we have one foot in the house of God and one foot in the world, because we want to blend and we want to be all things to all men. We don't want to misinterpret the word of God. We don't want to take the word of God out of context. We don't want to use it to our likings. We don't want to cherry pick. We should be taking the word of God for what it is. Now, one of the things about being messed up, being that we all come from different walks of life. So the people of God, the individuals that make up the body, the individuals that help make up the church. So no one, no single person is the church by themselves. No one person is the body by themselves. The church is considered a group of people that make up a church, or a group of people that makes up a body. And so we, those that have decided to follow Jesus Christ, we are the people of God. We are the church. We are the body. We are his ambassadors here in the earth. We come from different walks of life. We come from different paths. We have, all of us have different passes, and many of us have experienced more things than others. And so we have now been called and commanded to come together, to join as one, to be unified as one. And that's not always easy. That's not always easy in the body of Christ, because you're dealing with many, many personalities. You're dealing with people's weaknesses, people's flaws, people's characters. And through all of that, you are commanded to love people beyond what is on display. So in the world, so we were taught a lot of different things in the world, that when you come to Christ, those things have to be undone. You have to be cleansed and purified of the things that you had in the world. There were so many different false beliefs, so many different false perspectives that we were taught in the world, that we took on and that we brought into our Christian faith, our Christian walk, that God is requiring for us to cut ties with. So one of the things that I wanted to make mention, you know, in a world we were taught that you can cut people off. If you didn't like that person's personality, if you didn't like the way that person flowed or the way they lived their lives, then you didn't have to have any dealings with them. You didn't have to put up with their mess. If you were in a relationship that you were not committed to and you didn't like, you know, the way this person lived their lives, then you could cut them off. You didn't have to deal with them. You didn't have to put up with them. You're not entitled to have interaction with them. But in the body, because it's God that does the choosing, it's God that does the picking, it's God that has orchestrated everything, when it comes to the body of Christ, you don't get to pick and choose who are your siblings. You don't get to pick and choose who's saved and who's not saved. So what I'm saying is, when it comes to the body, you and I, we have to put up with things that we may not want to. And instead of throwing in the towel, instead of walking away because we don't want to deal with people, because, you know, in the world, you have people who don't like people and they don't mind being alone. They don't mind being by themselves. You have people who the world would call a loner, meaning they do just fine with being by themselves. They don't have to go out. They don't have to mingle. They don't have to find anyone to talk to on the phone. They are completely content with me, myself, and I. They don't need anyone to cause problems or to make their lives more painful or more stressful. You have people who don't mind being by themselves, but in the body, you have brothers and sisters that you are commanded to love, that you are commanded to walk with. And so you have to put up with people. And that's not always easy, but you know that God does give, He gives grace so that you can exercise more love, so that you can exercise more patience. So you can't cut people off in the body. You can't just say, well, I'm not going to deal with that sister. I'm not going to deal with that brother. I'm not going to deal with these people. You have to know that we're all striving. We're all overcoming. Everyone, again, everyone comes from different walks of life. So people are in need of healing. So as God is cleaning up the churches, He's also cleaning up the people. What that means is we are a mess, but it's not the will of God that we remain in a mess. So it's not God's will that we stay the way that we are, that we come with the baggage and we come with our mindsets and our perspectives, because most of that, it came from the world. Based on how you were raised, based on what you were taught, you took on certain mindsets and certain beliefs that in the body of Christ, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. It doesn't fit in the equation. And so in order for you to be unified, in order for you to actually be able to walk with those that you are in the body with, you have to be changed. As they're being changed, you have to be changed. So although we can look at people as the problem, because in the world we looked at people as the problem. Hey, I know what the problem is. The problem is people, but the problem is self. The problem is your view about you and how you see you, what you think about you, how you think people should treat you. The issue is self. If we can get self out of the equation, if we can deal with self before the Lord, honestly before the Lord, then it will be easier to love people. Most have an issue loving people because of fear. Fear will keep you from accessing the things of God that He puts on the inside of people. Faith and love will position you to get what you need based on what God has put on the inside of individuals. So we can't be a people who's controlled by faith, or excuse me, we can't be a people who's controlled by fear, because we know that we can't have faith if we're operating in fear. And we know that without faith, it's impossible to please God. So I have to address my fear of man. Why are we afraid of people? Why do we have issues staying in the body? Because it's easier to stay in the world, because in the world, you know, there's no standard, no real standard, at least. You know, you don't have to do things. When you're in the world, you don't have to. But when you're in the body, you're commanded to love. You're commanded to forgive. You're commanded to walk in humility. You're commanded to walk in the spirit of honesty and sincerity and to be genuine. You're commanded to be a Christian, to be holy. But in the world, it doesn't take much for a person to live their lives. But in the body, it takes everything to remain in the body. That's why most people don't stay. They don't stay because, although it's a high calling, it is a calling that's achievable. So I believe as Paul says that we press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. Yeah, to obtain something that's incorruptible, something of value, something that's permanent, something that's eternal. We're striving to obtain something that will last. But he says it's a high calling. So that means that the standards are high, but it's not so high that it's impossible, because Jesus says with man, yes, it is impossible. There are just going to be things that you cannot achieve and you cannot accomplish or overcome in this life on your own apart from God. He says it's impossible with man. Man can't do it. Man doesn't have the strength. Man doesn't have the confidence. Man doesn't have the boldness or the faith to overcome the things in this life outside of God. So he says, but with God, so that word with, that is big. That means that I have to become a co-laborer. That means that I have to come into agreement. That means that I have to yield. That means that I have to submit to God. If I'm going to do this, I have to do it with God. I have to be alongside God, and I have to give God my yes in order for me to achieve this high calling, to obtain this high calling. So Jesus says that with God, all. He doesn't say a few. He doesn't say partial. He doesn't say half. He says all things, all things. It doesn't matter how hard your life was before and what you could not overcome. Maybe there were things that you tried to fix yourself. You tried to stop fornicating. You tried to stop lying. You tried to stop being a witch. You tried to stop manipulating. You tried to stop stealing and lying on your taxes. You tried to make peace with certain people in your family, or just you tried to become a people person. You tried, but you failed outside of God because it was so hard. But Jesus is saying that all things are possible with God. Things that you could never accomplish in the world, things that you could never overcome, the thoughts in your mind, the desire to want to sin, you know, the desire to want to be lustful. There were things that you tried hard to fight to overcome, but you couldn't. But Jesus is letting us know, hey, you can do it with God, but you have to become a co-laborer. You have to walk with God. You have to participate. You have to play a role in order to overcome these things in this life. So Jesus lets us know that, hey, there's hope. Although you're a mess, you're messed up, you failed in life, you know, there were things that you just could not do. You were incapable of doing and accomplishing. He's saying there is hope. There's hope. He says God is that hope. The Father who sent the Son is that hope. And with him, nothing will be impossible. You will be able to do all things. So that means overcoming sin. Yes, I love it. A co-worker. I have to become a co-worker, a co-laborer with Christ in order for me to make it out of this life alive. The world is going to tell me that, hey, it's okay to fail. Nobody's perfect, but Jesus says, I'm going to give you the power to be perfect, because he says that we have to be perfect like his Father in heaven is perfect. So the Father is perfect, and he gives his Son's power to be perfect, to walk out that perfection. So although we are a mess, Jesus comes to clean us up. He comes to deliver us from our old mindsets, our old perspectives, our weaknesses, our flaws, to raise unto himself a holy people. Because when he comes back, the Word of God says that judgment will begin in the house of God first. So when he comes back, he's not going to start with the world first. He's going to start in his house. And the Word of God says that he expects this house, this bride, to be adorned. He expects this bride, his bride, which is a reflection of himself, to be without spots, to be without blemish, to be without wrinkle. So when we look at the condition of the church, we know that many of the churches are far from that perfection. So perfection isn't just not failing, not doing anything wrong. Perfection is when you are being what God has called you to be, knowing that, yeah, you're gonna have flaws, you're gonna have weaknesses, but that just man, although he falls, he gets back up, he plows forward, he fights through, he presses through, he keeps climbing. He doesn't make excuses to stay down. He doesn't say, well, there's grace to get back up and to plow forward, to keep running the race. We don't drop out of the race because we have weaknesses and other people have weaknesses. We have to respect the fact that our relationships in the body are permanent ones. So those are the ones that we have to value more than the ones that are in the world, because in the world, you know, the family that you got or the family that you were born into, you got that by default, meaning you were born into this family by default. You didn't choose your mom. You didn't choose your dad. You didn't choose your siblings, if you have siblings. That was by default, and you had to learn how to love the people in your family past their flaws. You didn't like dealing with this uncle. You didn't like dealing with this cousin. You didn't like dealing with this sibling, but you know at the end of the day, we're still family. That's how the people in the body of Christ has to look at each other. At the end of the day, I still have to love you, but I have to fight myself, because there are parts of me that I've taken on in the world that says, I don't have to put forth this amount of effort. I don't have to deal with you. But God commands us to love one another. The Word of God says that love fulfills the whole law. If we want to stop the work of the enemy, then we have to be unified. If we want to shut down the lies of the devil, if we want to push back the powers of witchcraft and darkness and, you know, the different curses that are in the atmosphere, the strong man, the principalities that are governing our region, if we want to put a stop to these things, to the work of Satan in our atmosphere and in our lives, then we have to be unified. And the devil knows that when a people who are strong and are unified, when they come together, then he cannot stand against them. That's why the enemy works so hard to sow seeds of division and confusion. He'll make you think and believe that the people that you are supposed to be engaging with the right heart, he'll make you think that they don't love you. He'll make you think that you're being overlooked. He'll make you think and feel like you're not valuable. He'll make you think and feel like you're that same person who you were in your past. He'll make you feel as though, well, this is not accomplishable. Maybe I can't love and maybe I can't be loved. He'll sow those seeds of division and confusion and manipulation. And what he likes to do is he likes to turn everybody against each other, because if there's breaches and gaps and division and separation, then he could come in and he can attack in ways that may cause sicknesses. He could come in and attack in ways that may cause rebellion in the hearts of people. We're supposed to be unified. We're supposed to be placing the enemy under our feet and behind us. But that takes unity. And for unity to be breeded, that takes love. So that means I have to love. I have to see things from an aerial view. I can't see things from my carnal nature, my sinful nature, my past. I have to see things the way God sees things. If I see things the way that God sees things, then I'm going to have a heart for the things of God. I'm going to want what God wants. If God wants unity, then I want unity. If God loves when we come together and we're sincere, we're genuine, then that's what I love. In spite of what I've known to be life and what I've known to be right. So God requires for us to lay down our lives. And a part of laying down your life, you have to love people. You have to forgive people, even if they've offended you many times. Jesus says 70 in a day. Not just one time. Maybe you loved that sister last week after you all had some kind of confrontation, and now the sister offended you again, or now the brother offended you again. You have to love people past their flaws. And one of the things that I've learned is you also have to be patient with people's processes. Meaning, again, we're messed up. We come from different walks of life. That person, they're overcoming like you're overcoming. However, their process may be a little bit longer. It may take them a little bit more time, because the damage of the world, the impact was deeper than it was for you. Maybe you didn't go through what that person went through. Maybe you didn't have that person's trauma, that person's experience. And so maybe it's easier for you to love. It's easier for you to let go. It's easier for you to forgive and to walk in patience. But for that person, it may be harder. And you have to, I'm telling you, we need the lenses of God. We need his eyes. We need his vision to be able to love each other with the right heart, with the right way. If I understand that you're his child and I'm his child, then I'm going to love you like I know you are anointed. I'm going to love you like I know, no, this person belongs to God. And the word of God says, touch not my anointed, neither do my prophets no harm. Then that's going to cause for me to engage you in a different way, knowing that, no, this person belongs to God. Yes, this person has weaknesses, but so do I. And just like God is working on me, God is working on that person. And that can't be an excuse as to why we don't make the necessary shifts when it's time to, because we also learned yesterday of how we got to be ready in every season. We cannot have any off seasons, because just like Jesus, he cursed that fig tree, because when he wanted fruit from this tree, this fig tree didn't have any fruit on it. But the word of God says that it wasn't the season, but it didn't matter. Jesus wanted the fruit now. I know it's not the season, but I want what you're supposed to produce. I want it now. So God does whatever he wants. God does whatever he pleases. And so we have to be the kind of people, we have to be producing in every season. Some people say, well, this is my season. Even when it's not your season, you have to be productive. Even when you feel as though it may not be time for you to do certain things, you should be producing something, because your first responsibility is to be a Christian. So you may not have a role, you may not have a position, but you are commanded to be a Christian. That means you are called to be Jesus in the earth. You are called to love the people of God here in the earth. And so you have to be instant in season and out of season. That means you gotta be producing something, whatever it is. You should be working. You can't be a lazy Christian. You cannot be a lazy Christian. You cannot be a Christian that doesn't want to put forth effort and you assume, well, God is going to do all the work for me. Let me tell you something. Your freedom into eternal life, it requires your participation. It requires your hand at work. Yes, God's hand is at work, but you have to participate in it as well. So that may mean you may have to seek God for what he wants to fix in your heart, what he wants to cleanse you of in your mind and in your soul, things that you've picked up from the world. We don't realize how bad the world messed us up, and we come into the body of Christ expecting people to understand. And it's not that people shouldn't understand, but we can't hold on to that victim's mentality forever. Yes, understand that I've been hurt. I've been betrayed. I've been rejected. I've been neglected. I've been abused. I need to know that there is power in the name of Jesus, and that he comes to fix. He comes to transform. He comes to heal and to deliver. I have to be open for the healing of God. And that's going to take me engaging people, because sometimes the key to your healing is in that person's hands. But if I cut people off, if I don't want to deal with people because in the world I wasn't a people person, then I'm not going to get the breakthrough that I need. God does things for a specific reason. God knows that in the world you wasn't a people person, but he'll put you in situations. He'll put you in circumstances to where you need people. Yeah, you need people. You need to depend on people. You want to say good morning? Okay. You need to depend on people. Got to make it that way to where you have no choice but to lean on people. He will, I'm telling you, God will burn through the pride that you held in the world. Oh no, I don't need people. I can do things on my own. I'm independent. We were taught in the world to be independent, and that's one of the things the Lord is sanctifying us of, is our independent mindset that says, I got what I got on my own, and I get things for myself, and I do things for myself. God will make it to where you need people and you have to depend on people. That's so humbling, but he knows how to break in so that we can break out. He knows. He knows how to get to the depths of those things in our hearts so that we can become a holy people. He knows. No, I have to break through this person's unbelief because they think this way still. I have to break through the pride. I have to break through the stubbornness and the bitterness. This person has become so hardened, but there's nothing that God cannot soften up. There's nothing that God, like clay, he has to soften it up Sometimes he may have to break you to remake you, because he knows what you need. God knows what this person needs. In order for you to become gold, to become something beautiful, he has to shape you. He has to mold you. And sometimes that process is painful, especially for those of us, we went through some things in the world. No, this person is a little bit tougher. This person's a little bit harder. I have to apply more pressure and more force to this one. In order for this to come out like I want it to, this is going to take a little bit more. Yeah, a little bit more love. A little bit more patience. God knows what we need. And one of the things about God is he's not like people. God is so patient and so merciful that he puts up with us. And we know how we are. We know that God fought many of us throughout the years just for us to be where we are at now. That's his mercy and his love. Like, Lord, you put up with me even when I was kicking against the prick, when I was in disagreement, when I was in resistance. I wasn't trying to give. I was still trying to hold on to certain parts of my past. And the Lord was so patient that he stood by our side. He was so patient that he continued to deal with us, yeah, and to put up with us and to show us mercy. Yeah. That's his love. That's his love. And so how much more God? He says that if we don't forgive, yeah, others of their trespasses, no, neither will he forgive us of our trespasses.
No.
Come, you want to say good morning? You want to say good morning? You want to say good morning? You want to talk about Jesus? You talk about Jesus? Y'all, excuse him. But yeah, if I want to be forgiven of my sins, then I have to forgive others in spite of what they did. You may get tired of forgiving people, but God looks at us the same way. God, you know how many times we have to go to God? Lord, I did this. God, I said that. God, I went here. God, I messed up. And he's so merciful that because his name is on us, so God's name is on his people, he's not going to leave you messed up. He's not going to leave you in that condition. He's not going to leave you that way because he loves you. You're his. So God is into the business of changing and making and reshaping us. Why? Because he wants us to look like him. We have to become the sons of God. We are the sons of God, and we're becoming. So we are saved, and we're being saved. Yeah, Jesus is saving us every day. He's keeping us in his will. He's keeping us near the cross so that we don't go astray. He's keeping us in the race. Yeah, it's only by his grace that we're still here. Yeah, many of us, we broke beyond some barriers. Man, I didn't think that I could deal with people. But God is changing our heart. You don't even know the things that he's doing. It's like, wow, I never knew that I was capable of X, Y, and Z. And now you have a heart for the people. Because if you can't deal with the people in close proximity, the people in your gathering, your local assembly, if you can't deal with people, how are you going to govern angels? How are you going to be over nations? How? When God calls you to the churches and you have to speak like Paul, and he calls you to these different assemblies where people have strong devils and strongholds on their lives because of what they've been through, far more worse than you and I, how are you going to have the capacity and the heart to deal with them? Yeah, you're going to abort the mission. If you can't deal with people now, if you can't overcome these small things now, this is supposed to be training ground. This is supposed to be exercising of your patience, of your faith, of your love levels. The Lord shows you, where is my love level? Do I really love people, or is it all just in my mind? Am I doing this to look like I'm a Christian, or do I really have a heart for people? Do I really love people? You know, because what happens when it's your time to be the one over? Okay, we're going to lay like this. We're not doing this. I'm sorry, y'all. I'm so sorry. Yeah, what happens when it's your time to lead a group of people like Moses, and God calls you to do that? You may not want to. God, I don't want to be over people. I don't want to deal with people. I just want to be a Christian, Jesus. Yeah, but what happens when that's the calling on your life, to deal with people? So that's what I'm saying. We got to get over our fear of people. Our fear of people will keep us from engaging people and getting what we need from the individual. These are the people of God. We're not talking about the world. We're talking about the house of God, which seems to be harder for most people to remain in. Why do people leave so quickly? They can't stay in the church. It's because Christianity, it tries people. People can't try Christianity and say, well, I've tried and I didn't like it. No, it tries you. There are standards. There's a way we have to live. And when we refuse, when we don't want to be changed, I don't want to be stretched. I don't want to be pulled. I don't want to love in that way. I don't want to give this people my time and a part of my heart because I have to be vulnerable. In the world, I had up all kind of walls, all kind of barriers. I didn't have to love. Yes. So it's easier to be a vain person in the world. It's easier to be a worldly person because, you know, it doesn't require much. If you don't want to deal with things, if you don't want to deal with people, then you can go into your corner. You can go back under your rock hiding. You can go back to living for you. But in the body, I had to learn it's not about me. It's about Jesus at the end of the day. And because we lay down our lives, that means that our lives are not our own. My life is not my own. It belongs to my maker. It belongs to my creator. And so because it belongs to him, he's going to do what seems right in his eyes with my life according to the purposes and the will of God on my life. That shouldn't be a scary thing because we trust God and we believe that he's making all things work together for our good. So we trust God. We should not have a fear, oh, God is going to put me in predicaments and in circumstances that's going to stress me out. No, God is not he's not a bad father. We got that perspective from the world because we had bad parents or we had bad relationships, but God is not. That's what I had to learn. God is not like man. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. God is not like man. God is perfect in every way. God is love. He really is that. I'm telling you, the more you engage God and you know that, you really understand the man, God really is love. God could have destroyed us a long time ago. He could have left us in our mess. He could have left us a mess. But he says, I want to clean you up of your mess. Yeah, so that I can make you a son. So that I can adorn you. I can give you a robe. I can give you shoes. I can give you bracelets and jewels and diamonds and rhinestones. I can beautify you. I can remove the stains of sin, the spots of sin. I want to make you into something beautiful. Yeah. You were nothing, but I want to make you into something. Many of us, we were nothing in the world. Many of us, we tried to fit in. We were what the world called a square. Some of us, not everyone. Some of us were squares in the world, nothing, you know. And God is saying, no, I want to use this one. I want to use the broken things. The word of God said that God can use the foolish things. He can use the foolish things, the messed up one, the one who's been in and out of foster care, the one who's been the black sheep, the outcast of the family, the one who had all the failures, the one who was told they were never going to be anything, the one who was told they were going to be just like their uncle, just like their aunt, just like their father, just like their mother, the one who kept failing, who kept breaking things, always making mistakes, clumsy, could not comprehend, couldn't read, you couldn't read well, the one who didn't finish high school, the one who couldn't do math right. Yeah, he uses those kinds of people who the world looks at as worthless or unvaluable. What do you have to offer? What do you have to bring to the table? You don't have anything to offer the world, but God sees you as something valuable, something that's not discardable, something that's not damaged goods. Those are the things that God uses. Yeah, those are the things that God looks to in the earth and say, he says, no, I want this one. I want her. I want him. I want these. Yeah, they come from the messed up part of the state, the worst part of the state that has a high crime rate, a high death rate. He wants to use those people and make them into something beautiful, all for his glory, all for his name. Yeah, so we are striving to become more like Christ. We are pressing towards the mark. We're pressing beyond our flesh. We're pressing beyond the lies of the devil. Yeah, because we have a permanent place that we're striving to get to. This is a temporary place. And we're striving. And so whatever God wants, we have to be willing. Lord, whatever you want, not my will, but your will be done. That has to be my declaration every day. Even though sometimes that's hard, but that has to be my life. That my life is no longer mine, but it's in the Father's hands. So God bless you in Jesus' name.